Welcome back to another episode of Ask the Hammer with Jeffrey Levine from Buckingham Wealth Partners. Hi, I'm Bob Powell. And Jeffrey, I've got a question about retirement, which is something near and dear to both our hearts. It goes like this. What is the state of retirement and retirement income software? Can I trust what I get from my advisor? And what do I need to know about the underlying assumptions in these software programs?
Well, that's kind of a loaded question there. So I would say this, let's start with the first part, which is what's the state of software? The state of software today is infinitely better than it was in previous years. Software today is iterating so quickly. It can do so much more so fast and go so much more in depth than it could even just 5 or 6 years ago. It's really incredible to see the pace at which things are changing. It's truly incredible. Now, that said, where is it and where does it need to be? We may be infinitely better than where we were. We're still light years away from where I think we need to be and where I want to see this, because there's still a lot of gaps there. And most importantly, perhaps, and I think the question really indicated this in terms of asking about the assumptions, there's still a lot of this that is driven by the, a lot of this that is determined by the driver of the software, I should say, like who's actually sitting behind the wheel and doing this sort of stuff. The old expression, garbage in, garbage out, truly applies here. So I think one of the first things is understanding what are those assumptions. So the question here was, you know, can I trust those assumptions? Well, I don't know. Can you? Are they good? What are those assumptions? So we've got to look at assumptions for, you know, tax rates. We've got to look at assumptions for inflation rates. We've got to look at assumptions for growth rates on investments and how long you're going to live and what Social Security will look like. You know, there, I could literally sit here for the next half an hour probably and talk about some of the assumptions that will be put into a plan. But I think understanding what your advisor is using is the first, and whether they are realistic. And then perhaps just as important, if you are concerned about those, you can either adjust them in many instances. Your advisor can do that for you if they're delivering that plan. Or what they can do, and what I often like doing when clients say, but yeah, I'm not sure that that's going to be the case. You know, you may think that, and there's some real logic behind why. You know, I see the evidence that you're presenting to support why you say inflation is going to be 2% over the next 30 years as opposed to 4% or whatever it is. But I'm concerned we're going to see hyperinflation. I want to know how would that impact me. A lot of software today, virtually all the major software providers for retirement income, will allow you to run scenarios, like what if scenarios. So take everything you just did, Mr. or Mrs. Advisor, in this plan, but just change it and make that inflation 4%. Instead of 2%. And let's see how that would look. And you could do the same thing. You could say, okay, well, you know, we're really thinking that longevity is 90. Let's see what happens if I live to 100. You can do those things. And, you know, some people refer to that as stress testing, et cetera. And I think that's a really critical element of your plan, is understanding, you know, if your assumptions are wrong, you know, take it out and test it and see, because then you know what to be concerned about. Ultimately, I would add this, is that your plan should not be a static thing. Whether it's a document or something that lives online, whatever it is, pretty much the second you get it, your plan is outdated. And that's okay. It doesn't mean it's useless. It just means that this is where we are at this moment in time. In 6 months from now, let's check your plan and let's see how things are going. You know, the same way people always go to their doctor for a checkup annually. And, you know, usually it's nothing. It's like, okay, you're good. You're in and out. But every once in a while, you know, someone finds something. Hey, you know, your blood work was a little off this time. Let's, you know, you might find, like, you know, inflation's a little bit higher these past few years than we were looking at. Maybe we need to, you know, maybe we need to give you some inflation medicine here in your portfolio or whatever that may be. So I know I'm, you know, maybe using perhaps a cliched analogy, but it's truly the case, right? This is something that needs to be kept up with on a regular basis. And the starting point here is getting a list and understanding and asking questions. What are your assumptions? If the assumptions are bad, the outcome will be bad. And I can tell you, You know, I can give me software in about 10 minutes, and you want me to show you a good outcome? I could show you a good outcome. You want me to show you a bad outcome? I could tweak those assumptions and make it a really bad outcome. And so you need to understand what those drivers are behind it and whether they are realistic or not. Or at least you need to trust implicitly the advisor who is putting them in for you if you don't know or don't have the capacity or desire to learn about that yourself. Then you really need to trust that advisor and make sure. People who ask these questions, though, have that desire to understand those underlying assumptions. And there, step one, ask, what are your assumptions going into this? Get a list of the key assumptions. And do they stack up? And is there evidence to support that? I think that may be perhaps one of the greatest questions to ask is, what is the evidence that you're using to support this assumption? It's a great question. What is the evidence you're using to support this assumption? And the wrong answer is, well, that's what the software has as a default. Right? That is not a good answer. Doesn't mean the software is wrong, but that is not a good answer. What your answer, what you want to hear is, well, we base it on this research, or here's the latest study that we follow, and just something with academic merit to support it in the application of what your default view is as a advisor or as a firm. You know, for instance, with Social Security, let's just use that as an example. Well, the trustees come out with an annual report each year that projects what they believe future COLAs will be for inflation. And they give you a high point, a low point, and a midpoint. If someone were to say, and candidly, I'm kind of cherry picking here because I do this myself, but if you were to use the midpoint of that as a reasonable projection, well, it has some basis to it. Not that it's right. No one knows the future, but it's not just, let me stick my finger in the wind and come up with 2%. That sounds good. Or I'll just go with inflation. Well, Social Security typically doesn't go with actual inflation, as any retiree can tell you over the last 10 years or so. So, having a basis for that assumption, what is the underlying evidence? What is the support that you rely on when making this assumption in my software, in my portfolio? That is a key question. And I would ask that of any individual preparing your plan.